views and opinions expressed in this program are those of the participants and do not necessarily reflect the views of BronxNet or the program underwriters.
All right, coming up on this edition of Today's Verdict, do you have an elderly family member or friend who you suspect is the victim of abuse? Do you know what to do or who to call if you believe elder abuse is actually happening? Well, later on, if you own a small business, then you will want to hear what our experienced attorney has to say as we tackle the subject of business corporations. As you can see, we have much to get to, so stay tuned. Today's Verdict starts right now. Hello and welcome to Today's Verdict, the live and interactive show that gives you your legal rights and options. I'm your host and trial attorney, David Lesh. Well, Today's Verdict is always encouraging you to stay connected. Make sure to tweet us at Today's Verdict and hashtag Ask Today's Verdict if you have a question. Also, make sure to like us and follow us on Facebook at Today's Verdict. And check us out at BronxNet.tv/Bronx Legal. And last, but certainly not least, don't forget to tweet me at David Lesh. Well, before getting involved in a business, you should understand all the legal aspects of setting up a professional corporation. Tonight, we are joined by attorney Robert Barkas, who's going to walk us through the whole process. You know, people say corporations and they don't think they really know what they're getting into. They think, oh, just incorporate, no big deal. What really is a corporation?
A corporation is one of several different kinds of legal entities by which one or more individuals or other companies can operate a business. There can be partnerships, corporations, limited liability companies, and they all have their pluses and minuses.
Why would somebody even want to incorporate as opposed to just owning their own business and not necessarily setting up a corporation? Why set up a corporation? What are the advantages of it?
You can run your own business, okay. But there are risks in running any business. Basically, a corporation has three purposes. One is to separate management from ownership. So if you're an individual and you're the only owner and employee of a company, it's probably not too important for you. But if you have 10 employees, you want to keep your management and your ownership separate from your employees. But the second is, it's a way of raising capital. You need money for the business. You don't want to go to a bank or someone else to borrow the money, so you can get investors. And the investors take shares in the corporation, and their liability is limited to the money they invested. If the business goes bust, essentially, they will lose that, but nothing else. And that gets into the third reason for having a corporation, and that is to limit liability. If you're a partnership, partnerships are responsible for each other's operation of the business. If you're a sole proprietorship, you're responsible for everything that happens. But in a corporation, the owner of the company, whether it's one or many owners, shareholders, typically are going to be separate from the commercial and contract responsibilities that the company itself, that is the corporation itself, might have.
Now, of course, you know, for lay people, that means if you're not guaranteeing certain debts or certain issues that occur, you would not be responsible if the corporation goes belly up. Am I correct? But there are times where you could still guarantee that you will pay off debts in the event the corporation goes down. Am I correct?
There are two or three things going on there. You spoke about a guarantee.
Okay.
And it's true that just for the typical commercial enterprise, let's say a beauty shop, it may have a lease and it may buy things. It may sign short or long-term contracts with its suppliers. Typically, a vendor, that is someone who sells that business beauty supplies, for example, or the landlord who leases the space to the beauty shop, is happy to take to sell or to lease the property to a corporation, but they will insist on having an owner or an officer guarantee that particular obligation. It could be the obligation of the lease to the landlord, or it could be whatever debts are run up from that vendor when you buy things from the vendor.
So what would be the advantage of even setting up a corporation in that type of instance where your vendors are going to ask you to guarantee any types of debts?
That's a good question. But there's more to it than just that.
Sure.
First of all, not all vendors will insist on getting a guarantee. But secondly, corporations also are protected. Strike that. The owner or the manager of a corporation can be protected from not just contract liabilities, but also other liabilities. Let's say a tort, such as negligence or fraud. If the owner of the company is not directly involved in the fraud or in the negligence, then the separation between the ownership and the entity means that the owners will not be liable in court for whatever happens to the plaintiff.
Well, let's give an example. Would that be somebody stealing from the corporation? What would be an example of a tort that you may not be that others may not be responsible for your negligence?
Let's say that someone falls in front of the property.
Sure.
And you, as the owner, have done everything you can do in order to ensure that the company has done its best. It has told its employees to do everything they can to make sure that people will not fall. The cracks are fixed. The snow is taken away. Things like that. In most instances that I know of, the owners themselves will not be personally liable. The corporation might be, because it may have responsibility for the area in front of its business. But the owners of the business, just by being owners, will not be liable to the person who was hurt.
Now, remember, way back when in law school, you learn about piercing the corporate veil. For the viewers, what does that mean?
Think of it this way. The law is there to help make society run smoothly. And it intends to be fair to everyone involved. So if the owner of the company has done something, I'll use a bad word, evil.
Heinous.
Horrible. Heinous is a good word. The law wants to see that the person who was harmed has some protection. If the company has been run very sloppily, if the owner has not run the business properly, doesn't have books, hasn't put enough money into the business, or uses the business, they say, to perpetuate a fraud, then the law allows the plaintiff in that case to pierce the corporate veil. That is, to get beyond the individual ownership to whatever the corporation may have done wrong. Because it's really the individual who is responsible for the wrongdoing in those situations.
Now, Robin, most people who want to incorporate, they just will call up a number and pay a couple $100, maybe a little more, get a corporate book, articles of incorporation, whatever it takes, and they're 1, 2, 3, they're incorporated. But there's more to it, am I correct, in terms of protecting yourself?
There's definitely more to it. First of all, having a corporation is a responsibility. Corporations is an entity sanctioned by the state government. States usually take when they give something, and what they take is the requirement to pay taxes and fees. Now, depending on the size of the corporation, the amount of money that the corporation takes in, the corporation may have to pay a couple $100 or more every year to the state to maintain its corporate status. Plus, corporations have to pay corporate taxes both under state and federal law. There may be ways that an individual could pass through those taxes. The little I know is the corporation, S corporation, where the individual really doesn't have to pay the corporate taxes. It's passed through, the money is passed directly through to the individual. So there are obligations that the corporation has to the state. In terms of setting up a corporation, you have to know that it's really right for you. Is it the right entity? And is an entity correct for you?
Well, is there a more popular filing? Is it a professional corporation, an LLC, a limited liability company? What do more people seem to be looking at? Is there a flavor of the year? Is that the way it works?
First of all, the best advice to give to anyone who's thinking about this is to talk to an accountant, someone who knows their own particular business, who knows their tax situation, and knows what problems may arise from one form of entity or another. Corporations are fairly old in terms of the basic idea. Recently, there have been what are called limited liability companies or similar structures, and they may vary from state to state. What a lot of people like the idea of setting up a limited liability company as opposed to a corporation, because the rules for corporations are fairly well structured. There's a statute that's that thick, and there are lots of cases about what the statute means. And that means what are the responsibilities of people within the corporation and the corporation to the outside and to the state. Limited liability companies were set up in order to give the people who own the company more flexibility in how they run their business and how they operate amongst themselves. Let's say a couple of friends want to start a business. They want to define what the relationship is among themselves in terms of the money they put in and their responsibilities, how they can get out. If you put money into a company, you want to be able to show you can get it out, because these things aren't traded on the New York Stock Exchange.
Sure.
So you can have an operating agreement that will specify exactly what you all want to do if any number of contingencies might arise.
What about transferring shares? Do you recommend that, or are there other ways that you feel you could protect yourself if you want to give a share of the corporation to a family member or to somebody else?
As this hypothetical beauty supply store starts expanding, and it has two or three or four outlets in the Bronx. Not only do you have a manager in each location, but you have lots of employees who are trusted. Maybe people who put in money, but I'm thinking not of the people who will put in money. Employees who you want to thank for their loyal service. And you can give them a bonus, but often owners will give those employees shares of stock. Those shares will not guarantee control of the company, but they also don't mean very much to the individual because they're not readily saleable.
Sure.
I can't sell the shares to you off the street because they're not marketable as you would buy shares in a big corporation on the New York Stock Exchange. There is no market for them. Worse than that, when the owner of a company gives shares as a favor or as an inducement to long and valued service to an employee, that employee then becomes, I'll use the word loosely, a partner in that business. That shareholder has rights. Minority shareholders in a corporation, a small corporation, can wreak havoc when there is a dispute among them, because the statutes provide that minority shareholders have rights. And one of the things that happens with an LLC is that the shareholders, when they come on board, as it were, can lay out how the individual owners can be bought out or how they can be kicked out. Now, to be fair, when you have a corporation, you can have a shareholder agreement too. And that shareholder agreement can lay out a lot of what the rules are about how new shareholders can be brought in, old shareholders can be kicked out, as it were, and under what grounds.
Now, usually you're brought into the mix because there's some type of problem with the corporation. What type of disputes do you generally handle?
I'm a trial lawyer like yourself. And so basically everything I know about corporations is the kind of things I've seen go wrong. And the kind of thing that can go wrong are infinite. I talked about minority shareholders. That's typical, the problem that a litigator would see. That is where it could be brothers, it could be friends, former friends, go into business together. and they have a disagreement. They don't have a shareholder agreement, or they have one that isn't sufficiently, doesn't sufficiently cover their situation. And they have to go to court to work out their problem. So one can get rid of his shares.
Bought out or whatever.
So that's a problem. We also talked about piercing the corporate veil. I've seen lots of instances where someone gets hurt, could be with a small corporation or a large corporation as the defendant, and individuals who are owners, managers, employees of that corporation can be brought into the lawsuit too, either because they were directly involved in how that plaintiff was allegedly harmed, or they had some other reason for liability. Let's say you bought a corporation that had problems years and years before. You had nothing to do with it. And all of a sudden, you become responsible for that company's debts, for any number of different theories of liability that the law has created to protect people who are harmed. Now, so it's not a guarantee of being free of liability by any means.
And these cases that you're involved in, are they in Supreme Court? Are they arbitrated? Both? Something else?
I've done them both in Supreme Court in New York, Superior Court in New Jersey. I've done them in federal court in New York and New Jersey. And I've done them in arbitrations. And now most of my practice is as an arbitrator for exactly these kinds of commercial disputes.
We're going to have to leave it there. But hopefully, Robert, you're going to come back and join us and give us some more tips.
Great.
All right. Well, we have to take a quick break, but don't worry. We'll be back with more Today's Verdict right after this.
There's a shelter pet who wants to meet you. Meet one today. Visit theshelterpetproject.org. Adopt.
Every Monday night at 9, we talk to the borough's movers and shakers about the latest in Bronx politics, education, healthcare, arts and culture, and literally any and everything that's important to the people of the Bronx. There's a reason why Bronxites have been turning to Bronx Talk for more than 20 years. Because Bronx Talk is about you and me, the people of the Bronx. So we'll see you Monday night at 9.
Adopting a new pet is a rewarding experience. And shelter pets make super pets. Your new best friend will steal your heart, bring you happiness, and enrich your life for years to come. You can make a difference in the life of an animal. Adopt and bring home a shelter pet today. To find out more, visit theshelterpetproject.org.
Hey, I'm Darren Jaime. I'm the host of Wednesday's Open right here on BronxNet Television, Channel 67, and also on Verizon Files, Channel 33. Want to invite you every Wednesday. You get an opportunity to see what's going on in the world of news, current events, debates, public information. That's what happens here on Open every Wednesday. So we invite you to join us right here on BronxNet Television.
Wow, these are really good.
You act surprised. Practice makes perfect.
You don't have to be perfect to be a perfect parent. There are thousands of teens in foster care who don't need perfection. They need you.
Hey, did you know 2.4 million loving cats and dogs in shelters and rescues need our help to find a home? Let's go to theshelterpetproject.org and meet a few who are in a shelter near you. Harlow. Oh, she's one great listener who loves to hear all your stories. My kind of cat. Cerulo. is a sweet, goofy boy who's eager to please. Sounds just like another dog I know. So go to the shelterpetproject.org, search your local shelters and rescues, and go for a cuddle with your next best friend. Adopt.
When you're out there, there's no telling what you'll find.
I see it, I see it!
Oh, look at you.
There are some moments only the forest can inspire. Find yours at discovertheforest.org.
All right, welcome back to Today's Verdict. I'm your host, David Lesh. We are always encouraging you to stay connected. Tweet us at Today's Verdict. Well, elder abuse is unfortunately very common and varies from physical, sexual, emotional, and financial mistreatment. It's a much misunderstood topic, and that is why we have John Blythe here with us. John, thanks for making it here.
Thanks for having me.
I know it wasn't so easy, but you got here, and we're going to get right into elder abuse.
Sounds good.
Elder abuse, unfortunately, is on the rise. I've seen it in my building. I do some Article 81 work. Very briefly, let's talk about the different types of abuse when we talk about the elderly and elder abuse.
Sure, so elder abuse certainly is on the rise with the aging population of baby boomers. The types of abuse you see ranges anywhere from, you know, an elderly person staying in a medical facility, staying in a nursing home, or an elderly resident of a building in New York City not being treated fairly.
You know, I know that sometimes the elderly, they don't even realize that they either have dementia or there are things that are happening. They could be hoarding stuff into their apartments. But when we're talking about elder abuse, we're usually talking about done to somebody else. Am I correct? In other words,
correct.
It's not necessarily that that person needs a guardian and they're not necessarily being abused. It's that somebody, a loved one, or again, it could be happen in a facility, somebody is actually doing the abuse. What happens when that occurs?
So I actually see it in two different ways. You would see elder abuse, and similarly, there's elder neglect.
Okay.
So abuse is an intentional wrongdoing. I'm, you know, doing something to harm you physically, financial abuse, sexual abuse, physical abuse.
Give me an example, a typical one that you might see.
An elderly person in a nursing home facility putting restraints on them when they shouldn't be restrained, or pushing them, or, you know, striking them physically, or there's financial abuse, you know, taking advantage of their sensitive private information and going through their bank accounts and stealing money. That's an abuse. There's also neglect, which is where you should be doing something, but you're not, where a patient or an elderly person might be sick and you're ignoring them. You're just not looking after them in the way you should be caring for
them.
Now,
do we find most of the elder abuse that occurring in the nursing homes or occurring out in the community, or really both?
It is in both, David. In my practice, though, we see a lot in these elder care facilities, nursing homes, extended stay rehab facilities, abuse in those types of facilities.
Do they end up being medical malpractice actions as well, or just your common negligence actions where they're slipping and falling, can't get into bed, the restraints aren't up?
It's both. So if you're in an elder care facility and there's some medical mishap, meaning a doctor prescribed you the wrong dose of medication or gave you some treatment, or you fell out of bed and didn't give you an x-ray when you should have to spot, you know, an issue, that may be a medical failure as opposed to an orderly that's pushing you or fails to put up your bed restraint,
that would be
and
just
you fall,
negligence,
that would be general negligence. And sometimes it's a combination of both.
Now, I know that there's an Article 81 statute which allows for the appointment of a guardian for somebody. Do you recommend that the process be followed if you think there's a loved one that you have in a nursing home who isn't really getting the proper care?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, we, you know, expect that our loved ones are going to get the proper care. So if you suspect that there's abuse going on, then before you even go that legal route, you should speak to the management, speak to the director of the home or the facility to figure out what's going on, report it. And then if that's not working, then you should contact an attorney, and whether the next step would be to file some sort of guardianship proceeding or whether to file a lawsuit on behalf of a loved one, then you know your legal counsel will direct you what to do,
because
but should seek counsel for
because
that.
Because the nursing home residents do have rights.
Absolutely.
Right? And it's like a bill of rights or rights so that they're taken care of. What do you find to be the biggest injustice in the nursing homes, in your experience?
The biggest injustice is nursing home neglect, meaning that there are so many patients that they're not getting the proper attention, and what's happening is patients are suffering falls. They're falling out of bed. Patients are suffering bed sores because they're immobile and they're not being turned enough, meaning there's supposed to be some sort of turning procedure or schedule in place, come every certain hours and turn the patient so they don't develop a bed sore. However, the staff is not following that procedure. They're ignoring them and neglecting them.
Now, how hard is it to get the records that you need to be able to prove your case and that there was something that happened in the nursing home, some type of abuse? You still need the records. The records are being held by the same entity that you may be suing. Tell me what you do there.
The patient has a legal right to get his or her records from the facility they're being treated at. So there's a duty for the facility to provide those if they're requested by the patient or by a lawyer on the patient's behalf. Now, you're right, it is sometimes difficult to get those records because the facility may feel like if we turn them over, then they're gonna figure out
that we
did something wrong.
They're gonna see that we should have put the restraints up, or we didn't mop the floor or something.
And it's not surprising that usually the facilities that give you the hardest time, you know, with the records is the one that has the most egregious neglect and abuse cases.
Do you have any tips you would give the viewers right now if they're watching, they have a loved one at the nursing home now and they think something may not be going the way it should be going?
Yeah, if you think something is wrong, I mean, as a New Yorker, we know if you see something, say something, right? If you suspect that there's some sort of abuse going on, if you see bruises or sores on your loved one's body and you don't feel like they're getting the proper care, then start by reporting it to management, the director of the facility. And then if it's not addressed or if you feel like that's not going to do anything, speak to an attorney.
And you think in writing, make these reports, am I correct? Because it's very easy for somebody at the nursing home to say, well, nobody ever told us about it.
Absolutely. It's always a good idea to put it in
and
writing.
And whether we find you if we need to get a hold of you.
I work for Hack and Rose Law Firm. We're located in Manhattan and we practice throughout the tri-state area and all five boroughs. And we do a lot of great work in the elder law area.
Well, John, I know it wasn't easy getting here, but we're glad you made it.
Thank you, David.
All right, well, that's all the time we have for tonight. I'd like to thank our guests for joining us, and of course, you, the viewers, for watching. If you missed any part of today's show, be sure to check it out at www.bronxnet.tv. Also, remember, if there's a legal issue or topic you'd like to see on a future edition of Today's Verdict, feel free to contact me at davidlesh@bronxnet.org or tweet us at Today's Verdict, and make sure to hashtag Ask Today's Verdict for myself and all of us at Today's Verdict. Always remember, know your rights, know your issues, reach a verdict. I'm David Lesh, and we'll see you again in 2 weeks with an all-new episode of Today's Verdict right here. Take care.